Okay, we are now on the record as best I can tell. Hello to everyone. Hello, Isabel, Grace, Rebecca, Marcia, Jeannie. I'm just going across the Kyle and Hannah. And I think that is it for right now. But we'll, as usual, wait a minute or two. People are even, I think, slower today. As I was just telling the Kyle and Hannah that having logged on at 7 after, I expected to see a few familiar faces, and there was no one in the room. So I was worried, but see, we are having a few more. Julia, you're with us, good. And Chandini, excellent. Good, hello to everyone. Hope you had a good weekend. Sad day for the Buckeyes, but I don't know how many of you follow the NCAA tournament. I know Kyle, you did. And
how's your bracket doing?
It was busted the first the first game, actually. So, yeah, I put too much emphasis on the Buckeyes and Big Ten. So I think I'm in serious trouble.
Yeah, the Buckeyes in Illinois shattered my last dreams.
Yeah. Oh well, but there've been some good games, and that counts for something. And I can't believe that the idiots who sent all these horrible messages to Liddell. Gosh, that's the seamier side of things, and boy, there's no cause for that at all. And especially him, he's such a good guy in so many respects. It, works with kids and upright citizen and all sorts of good qualities. Not that we should have to vouch for his good qualities, but yeah, anyway.
Not to mention he's also a college kid.
Yeah.
Like, who cares exactly. If he loses a game?
He's just a kid, and it's just a game when you get right down to it. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. People tend to get a little too wrapped up in things. But I think we're all set. I think we're at a point where we can start now. So let me officially welcome you all. Jackie, you're with us, good. And Rebecca, Oscar, excellent. Kenna, good, just tuning in. So we've got, a good crowd, excellent. So welcome to all. I will start with my first an announcement. I hope you all got my message about Wednesday and how we're going to have a different kind of class session. did everyone know what I'm talking about? The message that I sent out about Wednesday? Yeah. Okay. So you just tune in at the at what would be the usual time, except don't tune into this class. Don't tune into this Zoom room for the class. Instead, you will get by tomorrow morning sometime, you should get an email message from, I'll put her name in the, I think it'll come from the organizer herself. Giuseppina Di Bartolo, you should get a message from her or from someone at the University of Cologne, or in its German form, Köln, with a Zoom link, and that is the link that you should use to get onto or into the conference. You can use it for the whole conference. The conference goes on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. If there's other, I'll put a. I should have given you the program, I guess. But I suspect that you won't find the rest of the conference interesting. I don't know if you'll find my talk interesting, but this is my way of making amends for my miscalculation. And I think it'll work. I think there's material in the conference that you'll find interesting. So here is the program coming at you on chat. if you want to have a look at it. But my talk will be on Wednesday at class time, starting at 11:15. I have put a very straightforward set of a couple of questions for you to answer that will show that you've listened to the talk and thought a little bit about it. And that's all I will ask of you. So Wednesday, we have this special type of class involving the my presentation at this conference. Okay, any questions about that? Everyone clear about Wednesday? Okay, I don't see any evidence of problems there. So I hope you enjoy the talk. Let me put it that way. Okay, so I will go now to my usual routine and share my screen with you and share my t-shirt with you. Today's t-shirt is in keeping with our interest in the history of words in English and what dictionaries tell us. It says English is weird. It can be understood through tough, thorough thought, though. And what's interesting there, besides being mildly amusing, is here we go. What it tells us about we can check in the dictionaries, as you guys have been doing with the semantic change assignment and the and maybe to some extent the metaphor assignment. Dictionaries are these sources of fantastic information, particularly a thorough dictionary like the Oxford English Dictionary. And if you look at the, we might indeed wonder why English has all these words spelled O-U-G-H that are pronounced so differently. It turns out that they actually have different starting points. So through comes from Old English thurch, tough comes from Old English toch. There are H's involved in all of them, but different, slightly different environments. Thorough was two syllables originally, and the H was even though there's an R involved, like in through, there was a slightly different context. H is in final position in tough and though, but different vowels preceding. So there are actually different starting points, and those contributed to giving us different outcomes, which is exactly consistent with our ideas about regularity of sound change and about the phonetic environment mattering for the outcomes. It also tells us that modern English spelling is a mix of historical carryovers that were fixed at a particular time and have not changed much in several hundred years. We saw that with the KN words that you encountered for the on the problem set, where the spelling has remained with a K in words like knee, the body part, and knight, the gallant knight on horseback, and so forth. The K has remained, even though it's not there in the pronunciation at all anymore. So there's a mix of these historical carryovers, the continued spelling of knight and knee and need, like to knead bread, with a K. But there are also some innovations in spelling, as with the convergence on this O-U-G-H spelling for all of these words that had H's alone in earlier stages of English. Just as a, we talked in early on in the semester about philology and the careful study of texts and sort of mining texts for linguistic detail. And I thought I can't remember if I ever mentioned this, but as long as the KN words are sort of have been on our agenda recently, I thought I would mention that we know that the earlier pronunciation of the of these words, they were written with a C actually in Old English. In Old English manuscripts, we find it written with a CN, but we believe it was pronounced, that the K was pronounced because of the poetic device of alliteration, which has to do with we often talk about rhyming end part of words matching, but the beginning parts of words can match. And when consonants in the beginning of words match, we talk about that as alliteration. You might remember that from your 10th grade figure of speech English class and discussions about figures of speech. But the KN word, I'm sorry, all the words that are spelled with KN in modern English that have ancient Old English counterparts spelled with CN, they alliterate with words that begin with a C and a K. So like the a word like kin, as in kinfolk, for instance, a word like knight alliterates with kin. And we know that alliteration was an important part of Old English poetry. It was a poetic device that was used quite often in Old English poetry, and there were certain rules about which kinds of words could, or which positions in a line would alliterate with which other positions in a line, as to where the words fell in a given line. So that we know that there are lines where we would expect alliteration. We find a CN word in such a position, and a C vowel word in another position, and where we expect there to be an alliterative matching. And that gives us a reason for saying that based on the philology, based on understanding the careful investigation of the text, and understanding the sort of interplay between sound and poetic form in the texts, that gives us a basis for saying that these KN words, the modern day KN words, were originally pronounced with a K, like knicht and kne and so forth for me. So that's the lesson for today from our t-shirts, my t-shirt, my collection of t-shirts, but our collective interest in t-shirts. I'll come back to this by and by, but let's have a look at the actually I realized, let me back up for just a sec and make another announcement about before we get into the more meat of the matter for the day. I mentioned with regard to Wednesday's class and the viewing of my presentation that you'll be doing, that there's a short homework assignment associated with that. I also, if you look on the assignments for the class, you'll see that on Friday of this week, I have asked you to turn in a progress report on your term paper assignments. And this is really just to kind of prod you along, to nudge you in the direction of thinking about the term paper assignment. It's not due until the end of April, but that's sooner than you think. It's just about a month away. So I don't want you to leave it to the last minute, and therefore obliging you to tell me what you've been doing on the assignment is a sort of way of offering a gentle reminder that you can't just let this go to the last minute. If you have not made any progress, I won't say it's okay, but it's sort of okay, because I want you to at least fess up. You know, I want you to own up to the fact that you haven't made any progress, and let me know, and let that serve as a reminder that it's that you should be thinking about the project. Okay, so there's a homework assignment due on, I think I made the one based on the presentation on Wednesday, that's due on Thursday, and then Friday, just before midnight, the update or progress report on your term paper assignment is due. Okay, so I'd forgotten to mention that when I was giving announcements earlier. So back to screen sharing then, and let's look at the metaphor assignment. Well, actually, one of your classmates, Kyle, gave me a great You know, I like cartoons, and Kyle was good enough to give me this cartoon. I'm not sure. I don't know the name of the cartoon, but I've seen this dinosaur trope before. Kyle, what is it? Does it have a name?
I have no idea. I took it from Dr. Papke's conlang class.
Oh, okay, fair enough. But what's relevant about it to our for our purposes today? Well, you see that it starts out of the dinosaur. It tells us they've been investigating English language itself. It turns out that it's horses all the way down. So this is mainly about horsing or horse-related terminology, but it starts with a metaphor from horse racing. Front runner is a metaphor from horse racing. The front runner in a horse race is the one who is in the lead. And then by extension, it has been applied to anyone who is in the lead in any kind of contest or race of the sort. And even talking about say a presidential election as a race is in a sense a metaphor in itself, because if a race is originally, you know, like a running race either between horses or between humans, the transfer, the likening that's involved in the metaphor of an election being like a race is that two people are competing against one another. And we can use the same kind of imagery, if you will, and talk about a front runner in a race like that, even though no one is actually running physically. They're running, and in fact, we use the term run, right? You run for president, you run for city council, you run for mayor of Columbus or whatever. So we use some of the same terminology, and it's a wholesale shifting, metaphorical shifting of, and therefore a metaphorical likening of the election contest being like a running contest or a horse race. Okay, and then he mentions some of the others that he mentions are not necessarily metaphor, but just other examples of transfer of semantic associations transferred to different either different domains or different words or different associations with forms altogether. So hobby horse, the hobby comes originally from small horse. The British military officer's servant was called this. It meant man in charge of a horse and its load. The word is Batman, and of course, Batman that we think of is like Batman and Robin and the DC, go DC, the DC comics and the movie, the TV show and the movies and so forth. But it was a different sense altogether. From our Batman. It also it's an important lesson there that words that are similar in form can have very, very different origins, and such that the modern convergence between Batman, the character, and the British military officer servant, who's known as a Batman, those are despite the formal similarity, the formal identity, really, they are completely different words that have nothing to do with one another historically. A lesson that comes out in the consideration of the Campbell, Greenberg, and Matisoff discussion. But why don't we look a bit at these at some of these metaphors? You all did a really great job of thinking about them and writing up your impressions about these. Did anyone, and in fact, I think all of them were covered by someone, but do any of you have any that you particularly liked or found to be particularly interesting or surprising even? I got really good discussions from all of you, really. I was very, very pleased with your industry and your ingenuity about discussing these things. Anyone? Did anyone like these? Like any one of these in particular? We talked about, where's the one about the spine? It's just a little bit bigger. So the projects are on either side of the campus, but they will have a spine connecting them. We talked about spine last week as a sort of stale metaphor when we talk to the in the context of talking about the spine of a book. But is, do you think spine here is, I mean, you all saw the metaphor, those of you who talked about this as a, you know, the likening is likening the projects that are connected, and therefore the whole campus being likened to the human body, with in the same way that the spine kind of holds everything up and connects the head with the lower half. The spine here would be the walkways or passageways, whatever, that would be connecting these two different parts of the campus, these two different projects. Does this seem to you to be the same stale metaphor or dead metaphor that spine of a book is, or does this seem to be summoning up a sort of fresh likening of the campus to a body? Anyone have any sensibilities about that? Any intuitions? No. Okay. To me, this seemed to be a sort of fresher kind of metaphor because of the overt mention about disparate parts that were being connected. That's again just my sensibilities. I should say that one of the things I found interesting in reading some of yours is that even when different ones of you were talking about the same metaphor here, you had sometimes very different takes on it. So there was one about bread and butter. Teaching and learning are the bread and butter of the university. And some of you talked about it in terms what's the metaphor there? Can anyone anyone enlighten us?
They're the like fundamental aspects of a university.
Yeah, fundamental in the same way. And what is the likening here? What is the sort of transferred domain or contextual domain?
Bread and butter are two fundamental foods, and they go well together.
Okay, fine. They're two fundamental foods. So it's sort of likening and I think some of you put it in exactly these terms, likening the university to a diet, not a diet where you're trying to lose weight, but a diet in terms of what do you regularly eat on a daily basis. Bread and butter, at least in Western culture, I think we might have a different metaphor altogether in a context where rice or noodles were more the staple, but the bread and butter as sort of staples or the fundamental parts of the diet. Some of you said they're fundamental parts of your kitchen, that you would have them there. Some of you mentioned, as Oscar just did, that they're something that they go together well, and therefore, and so there are a number of different ways in which you can interpret what this likening relationship is, but they all point in the same direction. So the teaching and learning complement one another in the same way that bread and butter complement one another. They're basic to a diet, bread and butter, and in that same way, teaching and learning are basic to the operation of the university. So that's that was the idea. As for this question of, let's see, the one here, the low hanging fruit, I explained that. And that was something that I can remember. You know, we have talked about change within one's lifetime. I can remember maybe 25 years ago or so, hearing that for the first time in administrative like meetings that I went to, where the dean or someone in charge of some office on campus would talk about the low hanging fruit that can be picked off easily out of all of the tasks that were before us. And that, in the same way and I can remember hearing that for the first time and thinking, oh, okay, well, that's a metaphor. I was able to understand it. I was able to grasp what the connection was, that the fruit that you can pick easily is the domain that we were likening our tasks, the committee's tasks were being likened to. The other thing I found interesting about that was not only the interpretability of the metaphor right off the bat, but also, and there's another metaphor, right? It's almost impossible, as I tried to suggest last week, it's almost impossible to talk about or sort of go through a day without having some metaphorical utterances, no matter, you'd have to work really hard not to be metaphorical, I think. Right off the bat, I think comes from is a baseball metaphor, that the ball jumps off of the bat when you hit the ball with the bat. So right off the bat is literally has to do with hitting a baseball. But if it's something that it's right at that moment of contact that something is initiated, namely the flight of the ball is initiated, and that's where the metaphor comes from. But what I, even though, as I say, it was interpretable at that very moment that I heard it for the first time, it became a very popular phrase especially amongst administrators to talk about low hanging fruits. Almost every committee meeting that I went to for a period of about 5 years or so, there was some mention of low-hanging fruit that the committee would be working on, trying to clear out of the way first, to take care of it first, as it were. So there can be trendiness with some of these expressions, and that trendiness, I think, can contribute to this what I was asking about in this second question. That have any of these metaphors become so solidly entrenched in the language that they are not really metaphorical anymore? So when we talk about low-hanging fruit, do we always understand it in terms of the fruit that's hanging off of a tree? When we talk about something, I think a few of you commented on this, the proposal, where was it having? I don't see it. Here it is. This hypothesis is complicated and has a lot of moving parts. Clearly, a hypothesis doesn't have any motion to it. And so the likening there was to some sort of complex machinery where there actually are parts that move, gears and rotors and such sorts of physical objects that do a lot of moving. And I think some of you said that this seemed to you to be so completely entrenched in usage that there was nothing really metaphorical about it. Even if you sort of stopped and reflected for a moment, you say, oh, well, I guess a hypothesis doesn't have anything that moves, but I understand what the intent is. I understand the sort of shifting of the domain of interpretation is. So, yeah, and that was I think those are a couple that you mentioned, but there was some disagreement amongst some of you as to which ones were sort of so solidly entrenched that they, as I say, they sort of have a life of their own. It's as if you were thinking about to get back to our what I mentioned at the outset, namely with my t-shirt naming, looking at dictionaries, the decision to put a word or phrase in a dictionary is really a way of indicating that enough people seem to use it in a standard kind of way so that it becomes like a fixed expression. And that's what I meant by saying that it takes on a life of its own. But we can, if we looked at train wheels, we would see that they refer literally to the wheels on a kid's bicycle that help the child learn how to actually ride the bike. They're the extra wheels that keep things balanced more easily for the child learning to ride. But in this context, it's sort of saying that what Imperial Russia was doing was really a kind of novel adventure, in the same way that riding a bike is a novel adventure, and it took off its training wheels. It really moved from being just a sort of threat in the area of Central Asia to actually being an empire that actually controlling things. So set aside there was no need for this extra support. By the time Russia got entrenched in Central Asia, this was in the imperial times in the 19th century, they were a full-fledged power, let's say. So if you, I hope you found this interesting to judge from the ways in which you wrote about these. I think you did, and I hope that you appreciate the issue that's involved here, namely that so much of what we do when we talk about the world, this will come up next week when we start looking into morphological change and the power of analogy. But this likening of one aspect of our experience to another aspect of our experience, which is really what's involved here in all of these metaphors, is really a very powerful way in which we interpret the world in general. When you go to a foreign country, I hope we will all be able to go to foreign countries again someday in the not too distant future. But when you go to a foreign country, you're often struck by the things that are similar to what you know from your own world, and things that are different. So you're interpreting what you see in a foreign country in terms of what you already know. And that's really a kind of analogical thinking in a much more general sense. Analogy is really a description of how we interpret the world. We interpret the world in terms of things that we already know, basically. And metaphor on the linguistic front, I think metaphor shows that very, very clearly. Okay. So any questions or comments about any of this? Okay, all straightforward. At least one person. How many of you actually liked doing this? I see one thumbs up. I like that. Two thumbs up. Okay, three. All right, it's a groundswell. Groundswell. Wait a minute. What's up with that? Metaphorically speaking, you can't get away without using metaphors. I think that's the lesson to learn. Okay, so let's think for a bit then about, we know from this evidence of metaphors and also from the evidence of the semantic change homework assignment that you did last week, we know that the association between forms and the meaning that they stand for are, those associations can change over time. And so So the question then becomes, how do we factor the possibility of what is loosely referred to as semantic change? How do we factor that into our calculations about understanding the relationships among languages? I think I mentioned this last week, but if you remember the very first linguistic comparison exercise that you did was involving the Burman languages. All of the, I think I said at the very beginning, all of this data has been sort of cooked and digested for you, and you're presented with this very relatively clean set of data that you just have to observe what corresponds to what in, and nothing more at the outset, at least. But the even there, we did have to make a few adjustments for semantics. There was one word that meant iron in one of the languages, but meant knife in another language. In all of the other cases, the semantics were the same across all three languages. So even there, we had just the sort of briefest of hints that for all the fact that we can find all of these matchings in form and meaning, sometimes the meanings can be different, even though the forms match up well across different languages. So that that was an issue or a potential issue from the start that we kind of just sort of set aside, said, you know, well, iron and knife, they're close enough, let's not worry about that, and let's focus on the form. In the readings for that you did, or the answers that you gave to the Campbell et al. The questions about those readings, how does semantics figure into the mix there? What was Campbell's take on the semantic side of the equations that Greenberg was suggesting, and how did Greenberg respond? I should say I've read all your papers now, and you all basically got it right. So any of you should be able to answer. Who'd like to take a stab at articulating what did Campbell criticize Greenberg for on the semantic side, on the semantic front?
Greenberg made a lot of associations between words that didn't have the same semantic meaning, and in fact, sometimes it was a bit stretched.
Okay, and Campbell called him on that, right? And Campbell said, "What was one of the ones in particular had to do with grass and green
grass, night, excrement, I think.
Excrement, yeah. So what about something like grass, green, and then excrement? Grass and green, clearly, Campbell, that's not what Campbell was worried about, right? Because that's a fairly straightforward connection. It was sort of the collection of all three, and the fact that, well, how did Greenberg use these kinds of meanings? To what end? What was his goal, really, in making the comparisons that he wanted to make?
His goal was to show the languages were related.
That's what right. So he wanted to show the languages were related. Did he start out trying? There are people who say that you don't prove a hypothesis, you test a hypothesis. And he was, Greenberg in a sense was saying, I can prove this hypothesis by bringing forth all of this data. But at no time did he really say what the criteria were for judging this data. And that's what Campbell was really reacting to on the semantic side. So, okay, grass and green, you might see a connection there. Green and excrement, under certain circumstances, you can see a connection there. How did Greenberg answer the grass, green, excrement one criticism? Anyone remember?
It came from dark of color.
Right, so grass, green to dark of color, and from that to excrement. So that Greenberg said that Campbell was leaving out some of the possible intermediate steps. And what we know from semantic change is that just even the little bit of experience that we've had with it already in this class, we know that forms can end up, forms that we believe to be related can end up very, very different. So I think I mentioned mother and sister in between, say, English and Albanian. You might say, well, they're both in the same semantic sphere of female kinship, kinfolk, but they're also there are very real differences between one's mother and one's sister in terms of the relationship you have with them, in terms of their age, in terms of how they manage the or how they function in a household and so forth. So that even if you can find a semantic link, it doesn't mean that that's necessarily a chain of inference that would lead you from point A to point B. So yes, we know that maybe this was via both, not necessarily one turning into the other, but both being members of a higher category of female kin, giving on the one hand mother, and on the other hand sister. So then it's you can see that there's a connection there without necessarily one turning into one meaning turning into the other meaning, or one association being altered in that way. Though there are other explanations I should mention for mother and sister. I think my own feeling there is that it was originally a compound, mother, sister, meaning female kin. And we have a kind of clipping and reassociation of the piece with the meaning, much as we have with like taxi, cab, being giving both taxi and cab, meaning essentially the same thing. There it's the form and the forms are the in each case, the form takes over the meaning of the whole compound originally. But if we started with this kind of compound, and Indo-European languages have these kinds of compounds. In English, we have compounds like especially with colors, a blue-green mixture means a mixture of blue and green. So that an original compound of this sort could well have been the starting point for the reassociation of one part of the compound with the with the associated with the other part, so that the form mother could come to mean sister. We know that like from taxicab, we know that pieces of words can be clipped. We had examples of clipping early on in the semester, remember, with Mendenhall. So we know that there can be clipping and then sort of semantic reassignment after the clipping. Cab refers in this case to the whole of taxicab. Taxi refers to the whole of taxicab. But if mother and sister were originally a compound meaning female kin, and one piece was extracted from that, then the meaning of one older female kin with younger sibling female kin could have been crossed, as it were. So there are other accounts that are possible. I've gotten off on a tangent here, but does Greenberg have a legitimate complaint here about Campbell, that if you fill in enough of the blanks, as it were, you can get from one starting point to some other endpoint, and that's what the dot 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 indicates here. The parallel with phonological change, sound change, I think is worth making, in that you can start with something remember the example that we had of the qu giving ultimately giving s, giving k, giving theta, and so forth. Again, dot dot dot. Where in some instances you could actually chart the intermediate steps, and that's part of what we were doing in sound change. So we know that in our study of sound change, so we know that there can be these intermediate steps in change in general. So does Greenberg have a point here when he says that Campbell is just being too not creative enough, let's say, in seeing what the possible intermediate steps would be? What do you think? Anyone? What about the parallel of you know, so we had the example of K becoming, ultimately becoming an S, let's say, where we can do it in terms of K becoming, before a front vowel, let's say, becoming a palatalized K, becoming a palatal affricate by a change in the release, she, like that, and then that reducing to a sh that happened in some of our gebe examples, you remember, and then that happened, then that ending up as an s there. With or without the vowel, it doesn't really matter. But we know that we recognize intermediate steps in phonology. Is there any reason not to recognize intermediate steps in semantics, in so-called semantic change? For what it's worth, I think Greenberg here had a legitimate counter to Campbell. Because there can be these steps, and especially as we saw, like with bead and prayer, once you take the social context into account, it's clear that you could have some real leaps of in terms of the association between form and semantic units. But how does Campbell? How does Campbell respond to that, or what comeback does Campbell have he anticipated that Greenberg would say something like that. And he raises the question of what do we start with? Would we start with examples where we have if we leave out these intermediate steps and we just have the dot, 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 and we're comparing a form that means grass in one language to the form that means excrement in another language, is that the kind of data that we would want to start with in terms of building a case for relatedness? That's really the question that Campbell is asking here. What does he say about that? Do you start with cases like grass and excrement? And how does that tie into the caution that he sounds about short forms? What was the issue with short forms that Campbell took exception to and said that we have to be careful about?
There's a very limited number of short forms, so it's very easy to find just chance.
So if we restrict ourselves to monosyllables, and if we're dealing with CV or VC, vowel, consonant, vowel, or vowel, consonant, monosyllables, then it raises the possibility of chance similarities. But if our comparisons are, say more robust and have, say 5 or 6 elements to them that match up well, then the odds are more in our favor in terms of establishing the relationship, and are more are less likely to be just a matter of a chance similarity. So the more robust the number of comparable elements is in a pair that you're looking at, then the greater the likelihood that you're really onto something there. So, and then if you sort of multiply Campbell's caution about short forms with his caution about some of the, about just looking at the extreme ends of a comparison on the semantic side, it's really hard to know what constraints are there on the kinds of connections that you can make. And I think that's what that's where Campbell is really trying to hammer home the lesson about rigor and reliability and verifiability, which leads me to a question that we might what is the null hypothesis when you're dealing with any two languages? Is the null hypothesis that they are related and therefore we look for evidence that they're related, or is the null hypothesis that they are not related and therefore we should be surprised if we find evidence of relatedness? Connected to that is the question of whether languages can be proven to be unrelated. If you have any two random languages that you take and you have under consideration, how can you demonstrate that they are in fact not related? Anyone have any thoughts about that?
The null hypothesis should be that languages are unrelated, right?
So the burden of proof should be on someone who says that the two languages in question are in fact completely separate from one another, and therefore the onus of proof, the burden of proof, should be on you to demonstrate that there is a connection there. I think that's the approach that most of us take. Someone put it in terms of the difficulty of trying to prove a negative. And so really, if you start by saying that these languages are, you want to, can we prove that these languages are unrelated? We're really trying to prove a negative about them. So the burden of proof should be upon those who say that there is a connection to be made here. There is a historical connection to be made. And that involves, as we've said many times already, ruling out chance, borrowing, and universality, and and building a case with the genetic or genealogical hypothesis is the proper way of understanding the relationship between the languages in question. So I think what Campbell is trying to do is really approach this from the point of view of this null hypothesis: can languages be proven to be unrelated? In the Hawk and Joseph textbook, I don't know if any of you have read this, but, or if you did read it, if it resonated with you here, but we say at one point that in terms of relatedness, it, in the absence of knowing exactly what the origin of human language is, it's not clear that we would have to start with the hypothesis that all languages are related. And it probably is safer, given our ignorance about what happened 100,000, 200,000 or so years ago with regard to the emergence of human language in the first place. Given our ignorance of that, it really is like a leap of faith to say all of the languages are related. We in fact make the point furthermore that we know that sign languages are natural human languages with all of the range of expressivity and communicative capabilities and so forth that spoken languages have, and therefore and we know sign languages involve a different modality, namely the manual and visual modality instead of the oral and auditory modality. And it really is very hard to see how one can make the leap from one modality to the other. So it's as if the whatever we say, whatever Greenberg might say about language relationships, and ultimately he tries to demonstrate that the that all of the languages of the world are related, but that has got to be tempered, I would say, by recognition that there's this gap between sign language modality and oral language modality that really can't be bridged very easily, if at all. So that we might talk about the relatedness of all oral auditory languages, or the relatedness of maybe of all signed languages, even though we know that's not the case, because we know that there are some signed languages that have been developed kind of independently in different contexts, in different social milieu, so that it's not feasible really to say that all human languages are related once we recognize that sign languages are indeed natural human languages. So so that being the case, it already Greenberg's view is somewhat watered down. The most it could mean is that all oral auditory languages are related. But even then it rests on an assumption that they all sprang from a single source, and that it wasn't a matter of independent creation using by humans in different parts of the world, using the physical and cognitive apparatus that they had available to them. And so there are a lot of presuppositions and assumptions that go into Greenberg's overall view that I think are hard to justify. So I think the answer here is that the null hypothesis is that the languages are unrelated, and should be therefore the burden of proof should be on those who want to demonstrate that they in fact are related. We also remember what we did with Hindi and English, the comparison of modern English and modern Hindi from last week. We saw that the evidence can degrade sort of so that comparisons made between Sanskrit and Old English were much more obvious and much more salient, much easier to work with than careful, Mary, the cat's coming. All right. I didn't want our cat escaping. Sorry about that. That the connections were more obvious and demonstrable between Sanskrit and Old English than between modern Hindi and modern English. So we know that there are related languages for which the evidence is not very strong. We could do the same sort of thing with modern Irish and modern Greek as we did in class with Hindi and English. But we know that Old Irish and Ancient Greek are demonstrably related in the same way that Sanskrit and Old English were. And we know that the modern languages are the direct lineal descendants of these earlier forms, so that they haven't changed their affiliation, if you will. They haven't changed their genealogical pedigree. So therefore, we have a situation where there are languages that we know are related because we know details about the history, their historical development, but for which there just isn't a lot of strong evidence. Does that mean then that the absence of evidence is good evidence? Greenberg is essentially saying that yes, the evidence can degrade, but it can degrade to a point where all you need is one point of comparison, and you can sort of build a whole edifice of relatedness on that. And I think that's a very tenuous position to have to take, where basically you're saying the absence of evidence seems to count as good evidence for relatedness. It's really assuming what you're trying to prove rather than demonstrating what you're trying to test. Okay, so what about Matisoff's point about Chinese? I should ask one of the Chinese speakers in the class to pronounce this word for two. Jinyi, can you do that?
Yes. So it should be
So it's. Yeah. It looks, when you write it like this with the E-E-R, it looks a lot more compellingly connected to Armenian than the pronunciation would indicate. This is a conventional representation of the word for two in Mandarin in a Latin based transcription system, but it, and in the same way that we remember the word that in Armenian is spelled like this is actually pronounced with an initial y. If you recall from last week, so it's Yerku with a Y. So, but Matisoff's point nonetheless is that if you take this sort of conventional representation of the Chinese word as if it were Latinized into E and R, and the Armenian with the ER at the beginning actually pronounced Y, Yer, and Latin duo, what was his point? He was sounding a cautionary note, right? And what was the particular caution that he was asking us to keep in mind?
The Armenian and Chinese forms look more related, but in reality, Armenian is related to Latin and not Mandarin.
Right. So if we're just eyeballing, that is, if we're just working on a quick and dirty look at the similarities, the way we did with numbers, remember last week. The Indo-European numbers, actually, it looks like you can make some progress, but you've got to be, in the same way that we saw that the Greek word, modern Greek word for one, ena, it looks like it's connected to Latin unus and and the Romance languages and German and English one with its N and so forth, but the N actually has an entirely different origin from what it has in the Greek word, from what it has in the in Romance or Germanic languages. So eyeballing is, you have to keep in mind that there are problematic aspects to eyeballing, and using that as a basis for saying, oh, Chinese, Armenian, there's, look, they both have the ER in the word for two. When in fact, and this is why we emphasized last time that it's, and it cannot be said enough that what we look at are correspondences, not similarities. I could spell it, be all right, similar. Correspondences and not similarities is really what we're after. Moreover, suppose it turns out that Chinese is related to Indo-European. There are people who have claimed that. I mean, Greenberg essentially takes that position, and there's some work of Russian linguist, Sergei Starostin, especially, and some others have bought into it as well, that there is a sort of very deep relationship between Sino-Tibetan, which is the family that includes Chinese, and Indo-European. And if that were the case, then Mandarin Chinese and Armenian Yerku would be, or Chinese and Armenian would be part of the same large family. But we could ask whether, suppose it is the case that Chinese and Armenian are related at a, I'll add here at a very deep level. Would this word for two figure at all in the demonstration of the relationship? What do you think? If Chinese and Armenian would turn out to be related, if we start with the assumption that the languages are not related, but we have to demonstrate that they are, if it were possible to demonstrate that they are related, would this word for two figure in that demonstration at all, do you think?
I think so.
Who's that?
It's Kenna.
Kenna, tell me.
I know it's two is probably on the Swadesh list, right?
Yeah.
So I feel like languages with the similar words on that list are probably deeply related to each other.
Was that the point of the Swadesh list?
I don't know. The Swadesh list, you weren't going to borrow stuff from that list, was the point.
Well, I guess what I'm sort of fishing for here is the idea that if you're able to demonstrate a relationship between Chinese and Armenian, which would mean a relationship between Sino-Tibetan and Indo-European, mm-hmm. then it would hinge on a number on being able to identify a number of correspondences of form that are not a matter of chance, borrowing, or universality. And therefore, it's very unlikely that this one modern word, especially since if they are related, it would be, as I say, at a very deep level. By deep, I mean chronologically deep. So if the Indo-European family is goes back to, say, 6,500 years before present, say 4,500 BC or thereabouts, give or take even 1,000 years, the relationship between Sino-Tibetan and Indo-European would be an order of magnitude or more deeper, chronologically speaking, so that it's unlikely, I would think, that the word for, that this apparent similarity in the word for two would really be a sort of linchpin, would really be the key element that you would base a demonstration of relationship on. That's how it seems to me. Kenna, do you want to?
Yeah, I feel like that makes sense.
Okay, you don't have to give in so easily.
Yeah, I just think we just need more. We need more words to look at. We can't just hinge it on one. Mastyov is like,
Hey, Greenberg, you use like one correspondence to say that they're related. I think you need some more evidence.
Yeah. And I think that's basically what the argument boils down to is exactly that one element is probably not enough. Even if Chinese and Armenian are related, it's unlikely that after 30,000 years or so that similarity would manifest itself just in this word for two. And I think that was the real point that Matisoff was trying to make there. Of course, I asked you to think about t-shirts because of my fetish about t-shirts. But what was his point about the etymology of t-shirt? Within 50 years or so of the existence of such a word and such a referent. What did he say was the quote real etymology of t-shirt?
I think I could answer this one too.
Okay, go for it.
Well, the t-shirt, the top of the, or like looking at the letter T, capital T, the horizontal line at the top is like the sleeves of the shirt, and then the vertical line is it going down your torso.
Yeah, exactly. So this is, so all of the pictures that I've shown you of the t-shirts are sort of laid out this way, and it's kind of like the arms are kind of like the arms of the T, speaking metaphorically, and the body is like the body of the T, again speaking metaphorically. So that Matisoff says that his understanding is that the t-shirt was so named because of its shape, but it's taken on other associations. The T standing for tennis, because you often wear a t-shirt when you play tennis, or T like a golf tee, which is shaped kind of like a T, namely narrow at the bottom and then branching out up at the top, not exactly a T, but sort of T-shaped, letter T-shaped. And he said that if in just 50 years or so, in the public consciousness, to the extent that anyone worries about why a t-shirt is called a t-shirt, but in the public consciousness, if the idea behind the naming of a t-shirt is so obscured, even though we have all the evidence right in front of us, namely the t-shirt and the letter and the golf tee and so forth, if it's so obscured, he says we really have to be careful about the etymology of any of the words that we propose. And he wasn't saying he was sounding a cautionary note, saying can we be sure of any etymology? And the answer is, well, you really have to nail down the details to be able to say that we have the true etymology. Remember the etymology of the word etymology referred to the true meaning, or we might say the true origin of the word. So then it comes down to, and this is a point I think I made early on in this semester, was that so much of what we do in historical linguistics involves drawing etymological connections between words so that we can chart their history. Even something as straightforward as Old English father and Modern English father, we assume that there's a connection between them and go from there. If you said, well, there is no connection, if it's like the connection between herion and praise in that first passage that you looked at between Old English and modern English, where we decided that there was no connection, that sort of herion kind of hit a wall, as it were, and just sort of ended up being completely gone from the language, whereas praise entered the language, so that there was no direct lineal connection there. But in the case of fader and father, we decided that there was that there was a direct lineal connection. So that So much of what we do rests on making etymological connections. Matisoff says, okay, we got to be careful because it's hard to know what the etymology is even of words that we've lived through the creation of. And so how do we judge then whether what makes for a suitable etymology? I wanted to just show you a little bit about how, you know, what has been proposed as deeper connections. One that you might have heard of, and it's certainly talked about in the textbook, is the so-called Nostratic family, where the connections are made amongst Afro-Asiatic languages, which take in the Semitic languages and most and a good many of the languages across Northern Africa and even into parts of Western Africa. Kartvelian are the languages of four languages. It's a relatively small family in terms of the languages, the number of languages in the Caucasus, including Georgian, for instance. Dravidian languages of southern India, and then Eurasiatic, including Indo-European, Uralic, and Altaic. This is a hypothesis that's been made. It's far from demonstrated, and in fact, most historical linguists tend to think of this as like a pipe dream that was thought of in the 19th century and has many adherents, but it rests on exactly the kinds of problematic associations between short forms and broad semantic latitude and and, you know, misdividing of words and so forth, so that you're comparing the wrong pieces. Remember what I've told you about what Calvert Watkins said about the comparative method. The first rule is you've got to know what to compare. So that the connections can be really kind of loose. So this is, I think I mentioned this briefly last week, but here are some words as reconstructed for Proto-Indo-European and some words reconstructed for Uralic, which includes languages like Finnish and Hungarian and Estonian. And there are some striking similarities. And Greenberg might even say, look, some of them involve grammatical material, which is a more restricted set. But is this enough to go on? And this is sort of a judgment call in a way. And moreover, in some instances, the reconstructions have been reassessed. And so while Nomen is, you can find this as the starting point in, you know, in various handbooks for the Proto-Indo-European word for name, a more modern recognition of the whole range of variants gives it a form that looks more like this: an initial glottal stop, a syllabic N, and a velar spirant. So it's just something like hum, which is not very much like the Uralic word nime. So this may be a case where there's a sort of false matching based on a misinterpretation of the or misconstrual of what the Proto-Indo-European what the evidence is for pointing to a Proto-Indo-European form for name. And even so, with these 10 words, not even 10, be enough to establish a connection between Indo-European and Uralic. Nonetheless, let's see, I still have a couple minutes, I think. Well, one more minute. Let me give you one more family tree of just to show that it's possible to do this kind of relatedness on languages that really any group of languages. We had examples from Polynesian, you remember, in one of our comparative problems, and we had Maori, Hawaiian, Samoan and Fijian, and they all represent then a part of a Malayo-Polynesian family. I should mention that we talked about them in the homework assignment as if they were all Polynesian, but in fact they are they're Fijian is sort of out in this one view of the interrelationships within the family. Fijian is sort of outside of Polynesian proper, but Maori, Hawaiian, and Samoan are within. So, and this comes back to the question of decisions that one makes about subgrouping. To the extent that Greenberg, is essentially saying that all languages are related, and therefore, as Matisoff put it, I think, is it just to be left to the drones to pick up the pieces of the droppings and fill in the blanks, as it were? In a sense, there's still interesting historical questions to ask, even if all of the languages are related. We know that there's huge differentiation amongst the languages of the world, and therefore we still have to understand how languages can diverge from one another and end up looking so different. Okay, so I will stop sharing and stop at that point. Wednesday, you remember, you have you'll have the experience of listening to me in a different mode. I'll still be sitting right here, but I'll be speaking to this conference, and I hope you'll find it entertaining at least. And then we'll meet again on a week from today for a regular class session at this venue. And we'll move into talking about morphological change at that point. Okay, great. Thank you all for showing up, and I will see you in a week. Maybe I'll glimpse you on Wednesday.
Thank you.
Take care, everyone. Okay.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.